Hey folks, thanks for tuning in. I'm Piano Man Steve Lundgren, creator of the Piano Man Approach online piano course and founder of pianomanapproach.com and learningmusicisfun.com. Appreciate you being here. We're going to be taking a look at how we can do something on piano with Annie's Song by John Denver. This is one I've been getting a lot of requests from my own student base from around the And I've got a lot of folks from around the world that have been asking me about this particular song for a few years, so I thought it was time we tackled it. And I really like the idea because this song has two interesting challenges. First and foremost, it, to my ear, I don't think there was any piano whatsoever in the song. So we're not going to be able to like rely on somebody's piano part. We got to figure something out to approximate the group, even though this instrument wasn't featured in it anywhere. The other thing is that it's in 3/4 time, which is a little bit more unusual. So it's either in 3/4 or 6/8. I actually think it feels more like 6/8, but all the sheet music I've seen has got it written in 3/4, but you can count it either way. The point is we're going to be feeling it in 3, not in 4. So it's going to be a fun and interesting challenge. So just before we get cranking here on the tutorial itself, let me just quickly ask you that if you enjoy content like this, we do this every Friday. It's Free Lesson Friday. If you enjoy this sort of thing, please give this video a like and leave a comment down below and share it with people you think might enjoy it and subscribe to my channel and all that good stuff and check out my links down below. You can opt into my mailing list and get alerts every time I put new stuff out, and I link to all of it in my blog so that it's easier to find, all that good stuff. And I have free goodies over there, and you can learn about my courses. So you know all of that stuff. PianoManApproach.com. We'd love to have you come be part of our family there. But now that I've got that out of the way, let's get started with our song demonstration today. So what we're going to be doing here, this is not a note-for-note tutorial. I don't do a lot of those, but what I am going to show you is how you can use the core tenets of my method, which is chords, rhythm patterns, and kind of easy chord-based improv to approximate this song. And we're going to be using my magic five-step formula for learning songs that I call the glide formula, because when you know these steps, you can glide right through learning pretty much any song you want to in popular music. So let me bring that up on the screen here, the glide formula. As you can see, the first letters of each step from glide represent something. It's an acronym. Step one is G, get the chords. In some cases, you can find chords for free with song lyrics, and other times you might have to purchase some sheet music or something from like Hal Leonard or some other music store or supplier. But we're going to ignore the written notes that are on the staff, if there are any. That's not what we're here to do. We're just going to look at the guitar chords. So that's the key. You got to find guitar chords. I hate it that they call them guitar chords, but a lot of people think of them that way. They're just the chords that you can use with any instrument. Step two, L, listen to the song. That's something in this day and age, we're living in a golden era. You can listen to about any song you want in multiple different places. So find it on YouTube, find it on Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon Music, many more, whatever. Pick your poison and take a listen to the tune now or after you've seen the full demo. And as you're listening, step three is I in glide, which is identify the feel. And what that is that I have four essential feels that I teach at the Piano Man Approach that are the basis for pretty much, if it's not 100%, it's certainly 90 to 95% of all popular music. And what it's going to do is it's going to give us a starting place, a rhythm pattern that's a starting place to start taking those chords and making them into the song. And we're going to take a look at those four feels, and you try to identify which of those four feels is the right one for this song as you're listening to it. Then step four is the D in glide, which is drill it down. That means to simply play through it several times in a very, very simplistic fashion. No flourishes on the chords and nothing special with the rhythm pattern, just to get the chord progression and the sequence under your hands so that as you move on to enhancing the song a little bit, you can focus on the enhancements and you're not using up valuable brain energy, you know, trying to figure out how do I get from, you know, what's the next chord and how do I get from the chord I'm on to that one, et cetera, et cetera. Finally, step five is the E, which is enhance with simple improv and signatures, which means use the easy improvisation techniques based on the chords that you're already playing and in more specific and price and look for more specific and precise signature lines that are identified with the tune if you know them. And we're going to look at that too. So let me bring that off the screen. Let's get back to our teaching apparatus here. So now that you know the process that we're going to go through, let's assume that you've already made it through steps one and two, okay? You found the chords and you listened to the song. You got the chords, listened to the tune, and now we're ready to pick our essential feel. And if you had listened to that tune, you would know that it's feeling in 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's not four beats per measure. That makes our work pretty easy because out of the four essential feels, three of them are four beats per measure or two beats per measure based, right? None of those are going to work. So the only one that we can go to is the waltz pattern. And the waltz pattern in my essential feels goes like this. You play the root of the chord in your left hand, one, and then you simply play the chord on two and three, right? We're in the key of D major in this song. I have the lyrics and the chords all down in the video description there. Just scroll down toward the bottom and you'll see the whole song, the lyrics to the song written out and the chords correlated above them so that you don't have to go searching for them anywhere else. So this will be right. You can just study it right here on this YouTube video. And so you're going to be looking at a D chord. We're in the key of D major. And it's like this, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That's the waltz pattern. It's not fancy, but it's a place to start, right? You fill up my G. You go to a G chord, senses. So the idea behind it is to just have something that begins to create a rhythmic foundation, a rhythmic structure behind the song. So we found our rhythm pattern because it's the only one that can work because the other three are all based on four beats per measure. All right. So now we have to just drill it down. And so that's where you go to the lyrics and the chords that I provided down there in the video description. And you just kind of work through it several times and you get used to playing the melody, so or playing the chord sequence. So it's D suspended, right? That's where you sharp the third like that, creates a little bit of tension and it wants to release back to the D major. To a G chord, G, A, B minor, G, D. Okay, now, this basically goes to, there's two different schools of thought on this one. This chord could be an A major chord, A, C sharp, E, right? Over a C-sharp bass. But it could also just be essentially an F-sharp minor chord, over a C sharp bass. They share a lot of the same. They share a lot of the same notes. A has A, C sharp, E. F sharp minor has F sharp, A, C sharp. So I have not made an exact determination on which one I think it is. I think it's probably closer to the F sharp minor. And the reason that I think that is that I think what John was actually doing on his acoustic guitar was basically continuing to play a D chord, but just lowering that. We've got kind of a descending pattern in the bass. See how it's just kind of working its way down? So I think it was kind of like he was playing a D chord, but because of the presence of that C sharp, it kind of turned it into an F sharp minor chord with a C sharp bass. That's my opinion, but my point is that if you go to an A chord, it's not going to sound bad. And that might actually be what he intended, but I'm just kind of guessing which one is which. So, two, three, now B minor. And now we have a D chord with an A bass. So this song doesn't always have the root of the chord and the bass, which is kind of another fun challenge. Because this is a very different kind of sound than this. It's the same chord, right? But it sounds different because the bass note that you're choosing is different from the root of the chord. G, D, with an F sharp bass this time, which is the same concept as we just lived with, but now it's a different bass note. E minor. Suspended A. A suspended G. A. B minor G. D. Like I say, pick your poison. I'm going to go with the F sharp minor over C sharp bass. D. F sharp minor. B minor. Sharp, E minor, A, D, D suspended, D. Okay, so I was just kind of walking you through the chords. What you want to do is get to the point where you're fairly comfortable playing that, and you don't want to do anything fancy. You just kind of want to get comfortable with that chord progression. If need be, you can move your hand around and just land on the root inversion of every single chord. What do I mean by root inversion? Where your thumb is on the root of the chord. So with a D chord, it's on a D. An F sharp minor, it would be on an F sharp. With a B minor, it would be on a B. See the pattern? If that's what you need to do to feel comfortable moving from chord to chord. If you are already really familiar with your chords and you're not spooked by using different inversions of the chord, you can use different inversions of the chord in this stage just because it's faster, just because your hand doesn't have to move as much. But we're going to talk about that as part of an enhancement strategy as well in the next step. But just kind of want to get it under your hands. You fill up my senses. Once you've got it to where you can kind of work yourself through that chord progression without making a bunch of mistakes and kind of play it at a tempo, at, you know, relatively close to tempo, we are ready to move on to step 5, which is where the fun really begins. and that's the enhancements. Now, I just want to point this out before we get to the enhancements. What I love about this method is that with just a little bit of foundational knowledge, you know, knowing the names of the notes and understanding, you don't have to be good at playing scales, but to understand what the key signatures and the scales that go with the key signatures are and how they're formed and all of that kind of stuff. Just understanding just a little bit of bass music theory. Then you have a point of entry to this, whether you are a pretty experienced player or a much less experienced player. Basically, a total beginner or a relative novice can come in, and this is an awfully satisfying. If you've got no piano skills and no piano momentum behind you at all, this is actually a really, really satisfying sound. Actually has got more pizzazz and more, it's rounder and fuller and more impressive sounding to you as a player and to anyone who might be listening than a lot of printed sheet music is ever going to be for these kinds of songs. So what I love about it is that very quickly you have a point of entry for somebody. And if that's all the farther you can go with it for right now is just that, you know, the basic version of the chords and the kind of just the most, you know, I don't want to call it dumbed down, but just like the kind of plain vanilla version of the rhythm pattern, that's okay. But for those of you who have enough piano momentum going that you're ready for some enhancements, there's a whole bunch of different stuff that we can do that are going to make this song come alive even more in this area once now that we know all of the fundamentals of the tune. So now that you've got your reps in here, we want to look at two main places for enhancements. There's rhythmic enhancements and there's harmonic enhancements. So rhythmic is where you're going to create exciting or more interesting moments with timing and articulation of the chords that you're playing. And harmonic is where you actually enhance the chords that you play by adjusting the voicing or by adding notes that make the chords more complex and potentially more interesting to the ear. And there's absolutely no rule that says you can't do both of those at the same time. So my favorite simple rhythmic maneuvers are called toggles and arpeggios. Toggles are where you play the top part of the chord, or even just one note at the top of the chord, and then toggle down to your thumb, like that. Arpeggios are where you take the individual notes of the chord, and you split them up, and you play them, sometimes in perfect sequence, going up or going down, sometimes just in whatever sequence you want, but the point is that you're playing the individual notes of the chord rather than the chord as a block. That's arpeggiating. Okay? And there are options for both of those things in this song. So what we want to do is kind of merge the two. If you think about what John's doing on his guitar, we'll get to the intro and look at some signature lines in a minute, but or in a little bit. But let's look at the sort of the meat and potatoes of the song, just the verse, those verses. What's he doing? John's playing this finger pattern on his guitar that goes da 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 da, and it's like thumb, and then paint. It's like he's going in between his thumb and his fingers down here, so it's thumb, finger, thumb, finger. All the way through the song. So there's this nice flowing elegance to it, right? So what we want to do, we don't have to try and copy exactly what he's doing, but what we want to do is to create that flowing rhythmic elegance. So we have different options. Might be that the easiest place to start would be to play a chord and then arpeggiate up. So see what I'm doing. I'm playing the chord, playing the top part of the chord, toggling to my thumb, and going right into an arpeggio up. On that D chord, play the top part of the chord, the F sharp and the A here, and then D, F sharp, A. One, two, and three. 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 That's just sort of a nice place to get started. You might have enough dexterity to do something more interesting than that, but that might be an open point because it creates a little more flow, a little more flow than just chuck, 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 right? You fill up my senses like a knife. In spring time, like the nog in the rain. Okay, so now what's another thing that we can do? Well, now we can take it a step further. So we add in a final toggle. We start with a toggle, arpeggiate up, and then toggle right back to the thumb. You fill up my senses like a night in a forest, like the mountains. So see how we're adding that. We're getting close to getting the da 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 da. We're getting closer. We're adding in another little thing. Maybe instead of toggling down to the thumb, it's just we move from the pinky to the middle finger. There's nothing wrong with that. So that's another way to do it. Now, if we want to add in the final flow, now we have to do the toggle like we've been doing, except instead of holding that a full count, one, starting the arpeggio on count two, we have to do it on the and of one. One and two and three and. And then we can go all the way up and all the way back down on our arpeggio. One and two and three and. See how that works? One and two. Thank you. See how nice and flowing that is? Now we're going to throw in one other thing. In the left hand now, either as octaves or sometimes maybe just with the thumb, it kind of depends. I tend to do a mixture of both, but we want to, instead of just 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, we now want to add just the teensiest bit of a hint of syncopation. So what we're going to do, it's not actually syncopation, but what we're going to do is we're going to add a little pace to it by coming down on count three as well. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And like I say, sometimes I come down with both the pinky and the thumb, both octaves. Sometimes I come down just on the thumb. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's entirely up to you. It's a stylistic choice. It's going to have more impact. It's going to be a little, I don't want to use the word harsh, but it's gonna have a more impactful sound, and maybe be a little more powerful, so it could come off harsh at times when you do your whole hand like this. It'll be a little softer and more subdued, but it'll still add that pace when you just use your thumb. And there's a time and a place for both. And I would just play around with it and see what your hand likes to do and what sounds good to your ear. But when you get those two things rolling in harmony like this, can you feel how that flows like a river? It's gorgeous. I mean, what a beautiful piece of music. I'm not taking credit for it. I'm just like, my God, it's such a beautiful piece of music, and I just love how this instrument is so stinking versatile, and we can do so many things with it. And it, like, when you really find that, when you find that perfect little groove, that perfect way to slide into the feel of the song, there's just nothing better. There's nothing better. I mean, I have goosebumps right now. and I've played this song, I don't know how many hundreds of times, but it just, and watching it build up to that step by step, because the thing is, not everybody that's coming into this is going to have right now the muscle, like you haven't built the dexterity, the muscle memory. You haven't built the neural pathways from your brain to your spinal cord down the arms and all the stuff that's required to be able to do what I'm doing here, but you can build them, and you take it step by step. Learning to do this prepares you to be able to do this. Prepares you to do this. And that prepares you to do this. And when you get to this point, suddenly you sit down and the song just really, it came to life even when you were doing this. You fill up my senses, right? But as your journey with the piano evolves and you become able to do more things because you master these simple ideas, and those simple ideas become so solid and rooted for you that you can't not be able to do them, and then suddenly you're ready to take something else on, because that's like subconscious. It's like riding a bike. It's a done deal, that other thing. And this new thing you can give your attention to, and each time you add a building block, then it becomes yours, and you can't lose it. And suddenly, you look up one day, and you're sitting down, and you're playing the song, and you're going... Okay. Now, what's the next step after that? That's all stuff that we were able to do by doing rhythmic enhancements. What could we do in harmonic enhancements? Well, I think that the best place to look in this case is to get comfortable with different inversions of the chords, because that way you can move through the chord progression without having to move your hand around, bounce around, looking for root inversion all the time. And as you do that, then you can make choices about what inversion of the chord you want to be on, and you can kind of subtly work your way up and down the keyboard a little bit if you want, or you can stay right in the same zone. So what are we talking about? Here's our D chord, right? Now, maybe we're choosing, whether you're choosing an F sharp minor or an A chord on this one, with a C sharp, you can voice it here if it's an F sharp minor, or here if it's an A, right? Because here are the notes. What's an A chord? A, C sharp, E. Well, C sharp, E, A. It's the same notes. They're just voiced in a different grouping, right? Same is true with F sharp minor. F sharp, A, C, but C sharp, F sharp, A. Same notes. It's still that chord. Okay? And we call it first inversion when, if this is root inversion where your thumb's on the root, first inversion is when your thumb is on the 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? And then second inversion is when your thumb is on the 5. That simple. So as you get comfortable with the different inversions of the chords, now suddenly it can be even more smooth and more elegant, because you're not having to jump your hand around, and you can stay a little bit more in the, you can be in what I would say a more natural flow of the voicings of the chords. They make sense together. You're not all over the place like this. So let me give you an example. Play that a little slower so you can really, really see it. I'm not doing this because I want you to necessarily copy exactly what I'm playing. I just want you to understand the concept so that you have that tool in your box to reach for. You know, you want to have a toolbox full of techniques, full of things that you can use in multiple songs. You don't want to just learn this song. You want to learn how to learn this song, and you want to learn the building blocks of playing this song so that you can play lots and lots of other songs using the same tool, okay? So, but here it is a little slower. So just changing to using different inversions of the chords, that is a harmonic enhancement that is just really, really great. And in this particular song, I don't see a lot of utility in adding notes to make the chords more complex. I love to use added nines and make the minor seven, you know, minor sevens and that kind of thing. But in this particular song, there's something, this is just my opinion. I'm not telling you you can't do it, but I will say that in my opinion, this song is so pure and innocent in its nature. And it's wide, wide open. Now, John Denver had that. His songs are very, very much like folk music. They're open and they're simple, but it's simple in a way that is so kind of pure. They remind me like of dogs. You know how dogs are simple creatures? But they're just so innocent and pure all the time that, you know, their simplicity doesn't bother you. It's just joyous. It's love. That's what John Denver's music is. It's this gooey expression of love usually. And I just don't really see a lot of utility in making the chords more complex because it kind of takes away from that, the simplicity that's sort of at the root of what makes it great. So I wouldn't be looking to make the chords more complex, but you could do that. You could make like the D, an added nine chord by adding that two in there. You could make the B minor, a B minor seven chord. You could make the E minor, an E minor seven chord. So there are things you can do with that if you wanted to. It's beautiful stuff, but I personally prefer it wide open, just majors and minors, just like John did it. But I'm not telling you that you have to do it that way. You know, you are the maestro when you're playing. So that's another way that you can enhance things harmonically. Now, one of the other things is signature lines. And this song doesn't really have much in the way of signature lines, but there is that beautiful opening salvo. Okay, and I've really examined that a lot on guitar, and here's what the exact notation note for note is. It's D, F sharp, A, D, A, F sharp. And then it goes to a D suspended, so it does the same thing, but D, G, A, D, A, G. And at full speed, it's like that. And that's okay. I think that one of the problems that I see a lot of folks do on piano is that they hear a guitar signature, and then they try to copy it exactly on piano, and it never really translates exactly the way we would like to, because piano and guitar are such different instruments, and they have different strengths and weaknesses, and they each can do things that the other can't. They have different kinds of sounds. Piano, for example, doesn't have a way to bend into a note. You know, you're not going to play on a piano and have it go, right? And you don't have a fret that you can, like, do this little jiggy thing on it and have it give the note vibrato, or a whammy bar or any of that stuff. But piano has an incredibly precise attack, and it's got... It's got unbelievable range. There is no scenario where you can play as many notes at the same time on guitar as you can on piano and cover as many octaves and things like that. So they each have different things that they can do that the other is limited from. So what I like to do is lean into the strength of my instrument rather, and even when I'm trying to adapt a signature line, rather than copy it exactly. So to me, one of the things that's problematic about doing this, while it works fine, is that it doesn't have as much pizzazz. John was doing that on a 12-string guitar. And a 12-string guitar has the first four, the bottom four strings are, they're actually, there's two strings per, and you're covering two strings with each finger on the fret, and they're octaves apart on the first, on the bottom four, and then they double the two higher strings. And so it comes off like this. Or it's more like this. Actually, it's like this. It's really weird, and there's no way to do that on piano, and it just sounds, it sounds really cool on guitar, on a 12-string guitar. So what I tried to do was think of, how can I approximate this but utilize the piano in some way? And so what I came up with was this, and you can use this if you like, or you can formulate your own version, but this is a technique that I teach in my improv videos over at the Piano Man Approach called pinky anchoring. Okay? So I picked one note here. This is D, which works in the D major chord, and it works in the D suspended chord. And I'm using it as sort of a harmony note up here repeatedly, so that it makes it sound like there's more going on without having to like really move my hand around too much. Is it exactly what John was doing? No, and I'm not on his instrument. However, I think it harkens to what's going on, because that 12-string guitar has those octave strings that are kind of getting fit into the mix in a really unique way because of the way the fingering pattern goes and what strings he's using. And so it kind of creates a little bit of that effect. So that's how I actually do this signature line. The other thing that I do that's a little bit of an enhancement is I'm using the same ideas that we talked about with the arpeggios and the toggling to create that nice, smooth, elegant flow in the verse there. But I tend to play more octave chords, meaning my hand is stretched out a full octave, which gives me four notes to work with rather than just three. And so sometimes I use all four notes. Other times I'm doing the same thing, a little bit of pinky anchoring. So see how I'm just playing up here? So that's kind of what I came up with, and that allows me to kind of create a spin on that signature line that I think harkens to what John's doing, but utilizes the strengths of the piano and doesn't just try to copy what's going on another instrument that signature line was created for, right? So I don't think that if you were making that lineup in the first place on piano that you would decide to just go. The reason why they did it was because of how it sounded on 12-string guitar. So if you had written that on piano and you were writing a signature to open it up, you probably would have done something different with it anyway. So anyway, that's what I do. And by the time I get done with all of my little enhancements at the stage that I'm at in the game, it comes out sounding kind of like this. Into the song where I want more intensity, then one of the things that I do is I use inversions of the chord that allow a little more space between the top of what my right hand is playing and the bottom of what my left hand is playing, because that creates bigness and scope and depth. And then when I get to parts where I want it to be more subtle, you know, like coming out of at that last verse where he's like, well, I go walk in the rain. A sleepy blue. Now I make it smaller again. I put less space, and maybe I remove the octaves from my left hand and just do the thumb a little bit. Like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses. Come fill me here to add a little bit of extra scope just before the end. So, beautiful song, lots of fun options for piano, and hopefully what I've been able to do is offer you a lot of tools and a lot of ideas that will help you play this song and do different things with it, and depending on your skill level, and just understand your skill level is not the same forever. It continues to evolve. So just because you can't do something today doesn't mean you won't be able to do it tomorrow or a week from now or a month from now. So just keep working at it. You're always improving. Always, always. Even if it doesn't show up on the keyboard and what your fingers can do at a given moment, it's still actually happening. All right? Your brain's on the job. So hopefully not just this song, though. Hopefully these tools are something that you'll be able to recognize, I could use this here, and I can use it here. And it becomes second nature, and that is how you accumulate a very, very broad catalog of music that you can sit down and play, because guess what? All music is chords, rhythm patterns, and improv. All of it. It is all based on these same things, and so the better you get at the tools, the more music you can play with it. And the more fun you can have, and the more choices that you have in the moment, and the essence of the song is always intact to the point where no one would necessarily notice that you're doing it different, but you get to have a fresh, fun, creative experience every single time, because there's always choices that you can make spontaneously while you're playing it, because you're just reaching into a toolbox full of techniques. So That's what I love about it. All right, I'm going to let that be enough for today. I hope that this has been valuable to you. That's always my goal. Please, again, check my links down there. Come visit us at pianomanapproach.com. Get some free goodies. Sign up for my mailing list. Get alerts for all of my new content, the free Lesson Friday content, and all of my performance content and all that good stuff. If you like, we'd love to have you be part of the community. And you can learn more about my courses over there as well. And remember my personal mantra, folks, not mantra, mantra. If you're not having fun when you're making music, you're doing it wrong. All right, guys, I will see you on the next one. So Piano Man Steve signing out for now. Bye-bye.